hear the same thing. So how do you protect without protection? Unless there is a paradigm shift, a shift in framework from trade liberalization, so that nations can protect the economy. America started by protecting their economies. Today, America is protecting their farmers. That's why America is subsidizing the rice made in America. But America will sometimes buy American rice and come and take it back. Don't subsidize your economy. Allow free trade. Don't protect it. It's not fair. So the international economic order is not fair to Africa. A more fair international economic order will be the new one that would see to it that the global south also develops or industrializes. But how is that going to be possible?
It's talk about the protection.
You must have the capital. You must have the capital. That's right, you must have the capital. Yes, but you see, I agree, you must have the capital. The World Bank and the IMF can give the capital. But the capital they'll give you has conditions, conditionality. So we don't want the conditionalities. You give me the capital, I will pay back with interest. But they will tell you, privatize state companies. So all the state banks, you sell them. State enterprises, you privatize them. That's one condition. Condition number two, reduce employment, labor retrenchment. So people are asked to go home. How are they going to take care of their families and their wives? And the government in Africa is doing that. The third thing, liberalize trade. Let anything come in. Don't protect. So bad things are coming from China and they are coming from Dubai. You know, the fourth thing, devalue your currency. I mean, Kevet, your money is too powerful. Okay, it's too powerful. I don't know why the World Bank is not asking you to devalue the currency. But they may ask you very soon. All these, or the parity with the exchange rate, so that's what is happening.
And supporting us.
Yes, that's, but that has a cost.
Yeah, of course.
That's a cost to give. So the conditionalities, the conditions, and today they bring about another condition, political freedom, multi-party system. And some countries cannot do it. Human rights. I like human rights. Because without human rights, things will go bad. So the question is, can Africa grow out of poverty in the present economic order? Or we need a new international economic order within which we can make progress? If that's not going to happen, then South-South cooperation and West Africa, Africa, trade among ourselves is about 8%. Trade among ourselves. So we make no headway. In Europe, trade among themselves is about 58%. Asia is bigger, Latin America, Africa, only 8% of the trade is between us. The rest, 92%, between us and Europe and North America. That's not the way to integrate the economy. You know. So the critical question is, how do we industrialize? Sometimes we are not going to industrialize by borrowing money. We can attract direct foreign investment. But the foreign investor doesn't want to come to Africa. If even me, as I sit here, if I happen to get $3 billion to invest, maybe I want to invest in Japan or in America, because it's more secure than to invest it in the Gambia, where Jammeh loses elections. He says, I won't go and I will lose my money. There'll be a civil war. So Africa is not stable. Civil wars and the laws don't work, no democracy, and so on and so forth. So we are not getting the direct foreign investors. The investors are not coming here. And before the investors come, Ghana, we suffered a lot. We had to give them so much. Give them so much condition. Concession. You come and invest in the railways for the next 3 years. You won't pay tax. And when you start paying tax, you can pay 5%, not 10%. Labor is cheap. So you don't pay much. About $1 a day, so it's cheap. And
take out your money.
You can take your money free without, you know. And so in the end, you are still losing. You know. But because direct investors are not coming, then you have to go for loan. Because you don't have any savings. We can't save, so you have to go for loan. And these loans are coming with their own conditionalities. China will not give you the conditionalities. The Chinese loans are also expensive. And their products are not. There is a joke on the internet of a Chinese man who came to Tanzania and befriended a Tanzanian lady. The lady's parents were annoyed that the girl was going out with a Chinese. Then the girl became pregnant, and the mother was very much annoyed. So the girl gave birth to a nice baby, half Chinese, half Tanzanian. Then a week later, the child died. So they went and told the mother that, look, the child is dead. And the father said, I told you, Chinese products don't last. Chinese products don't last, they are inferior in quality. So, think, because one of the questions I'll be asking, one of the three questions, let me drop a hint, will be for you to hear. Okay. The bridge.
How they can influence Africa?
Yeah. I'll come to that in a moment. I'll be asking about how industrialization can aid, can help African integration. You see, the BRICS, these are new countries that have, they are Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. These are the new. They become very powerful, these countries. And now they are trying to establish a multilateral bank which will oppose the World Bank. They put the money together to establish one. You know, the World Bank, you know, the World Bank and IMF, we call them, if you look into the literature, you see the word Bretton Woods. You know that? Mm-hmm. What's the difference between the World Bank and the IMF? Between the World Bank and the IMF. Okay, you know, the World Bank, the actual name is International Bank, Bank for International Construction. So the World Bank specializes in construction. If, for example, ECOWAS want to build a railway line from Cape Verde to Dakar to link it, that's construction. It's the World Bank that you approach. It is meant for international construction. But the IMF is to help you to balance your budget. IMF gives assistance to countries that are facing balance of payment problems. You know, so you exported 10 billion worth of things. You imported 20 billion. You have deficit of 10 billion. The IMF will come in to help you pay the interest to them. So this is specializing in international construction. But if you are going to do international construction and you approach the IMF, that's the wrong thing. The IMF is there to help with balance of payment problems or your budget. The Kivet government does a budget. They are going to spend salaries, roads, hospitals, drugs, let's say 100 million. But the revenue from taxes and all that is 50 million. There's a shortage of 50. That's the speciality of the International Monetary Fund, to help you to balance your budget or your balance of payment, you know, problems. Now, the BRICS is establishing a big bank now with huge to help. Not to help. It is, and Americans are not happy because it is going to challenge the World Bank. But from the BRICS, you can go for assistance for international construction. Maybe at about 0.5% less than the World Bank. They are still doing it. The money is there. All of them, Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa, they all contributed. But it is a new pole in the international political economy. So let's wait and see what will happen. If Africa pulls her resources together, Africa could be doing something to you. You know, the problem is that Africa's share of world trade is about 3.7%. China alone is producing about 51% of world trade. China has become the warehouse of global production. Africa's share is just 3.7%. And it makes Africa irrelevant to the world economy. We are irrelevant. They can do without us. Only 3.5% of global trade is coming from Africa. Meanwhile, our debt is over $650 billion and keeps growing. You know, life expectancy in Africa today, in some countries, is about 45 years. In Ghana, recently, it got to about 55 years. So maybe some of us will be dying very soon. Where we pay, we will live. Here? 71?
73, 74.
Oh, that's...
For women.
For here?
Yes.
Then that's the highest in Africa.
In the ranking in the World Banking, we are on 75th position.
Okay, so give me citizenship. I want to come here. But that is one of the best, even in the world. In Africa, Freetown, Sierra Leone, is 45%. 45%. Last expectancy. So the indicator is if it is 73 here, that is one of the highest. And what explains that is so high here? Well, there's peace here. And so the indicators in Africa are extremely. In fact, in many of the countries in Africa, real income today are lower than they were 30 years ago in some of the countries. So if you look at all these statistics, you know, there are people who are very, very pessimistic. You know, pessimism. Yeah, pessimism. They are not optimistic at all about Africa's chances of. And so I think the problem can be dealt with somehow if Africa could achieve a measure of economic growth, if you can achieve economic growth and industrialize, that's the only way our economies will converge, and we can. We cannot continue to be calling for African integration based on Pan-Africanism, which nobody really cares. What is Pan-Africanism? Yes, we are Africans. And so what? And so we should come together. There should be a basis for that. Nkrumah and Cabral and all those people, even before that, Marcus Garvey, they had a reason. We were slaves. And as slaves,